Hi guys, I know it's Friday and it's almost the end of the day, and I'm sure a lot of people are actually gonna just come. So whenever we take a break, it gets half empty and then it gets really, really packed. Right now we're gonna have a speaker called Mark Haidar. I had the pleasure to meet him just now and he explained to me what his business actually does, because when I looked at the website, I didn't get it. So he's the founder and the CEO of Vinli, which creates a connected car platform. So he can make any car a smart car. So my 10-year-old car, which doesn't even have a radio, could be potentially smart. So can I introduce the stage, Mark? Would you like to join us?
Absolutely.
Mark, don't worry. People are all getting in, so you'll have a really cool crowd. Good luck.
All righty. All right, so what I want to do in this presentation is, can you guys hear me? Okay, hold on. Is it better? Okay. I'm gonna walk you through the journey of taking something from a concept to an actual business and product that is in the market. It's gonna be from concept to business, that's the title of the story. So just give you a little bit of background about myself. I come from Texas. I just forgot my Texan hat, cowboy hat. I have a company called Dialexa. Dialexa is a company that takes ideas to products and market. So companies or governments come to us with a concept or a problem, and we take that concept to an actual company in the market. But 2 years ago, we decided that we wanted to take products and make them as companies and businesses. So we started a new division in the company, and the whole mission of the division is basically we identify a challenge or a problem in the market, and we build a product that addresses it. And then after we build the product, we go and assemble a company and a team around it and spin it off as its own independent company. So we created a machine that takes ideas to businesses. And since 2014, since we started Dialexa, we built more than 60 products. And since we launched Dialexa Labs, we launched more than three companies. One of the companies that she was just mentioning is the connected car product. It's the largest app ecosystem for a car. Think of it like the Apple TV for your vehicle. It's a device improvement. All right, since we started Dialexa, we built more than 60 products ranging from missile guidance systems to airport systems to dental implants products. So we built a lot of products, but then Dialexa Labs, since we launched it in 2014, we launched three companies. Vinli is one of the companies, which is a connected car product. It's a device you bring and plug in your car, and the moment you plug it in any car, if it's manufactured after 1996, it gives you access to Wi-Fi, the largest app store for the vehicle, you know, on your phone. We also launched a company called Robin. It's robots as a service for your home care. One of the first robots that we launched is basically a robotic lawnmower that you can actually put in front of your house and it can actually do your lawn. We also launched a company called Profit, which basically, think of it as your personal financial advisor. Now we're launching a new company called Nara, and it's a stealth startup. So over the years, we have perfected the methodology to build a product and to launch a company. And I wanna share with you some of our experiences today. So if you have an idea or if you have a concept, what are the stages that you're probably gonna actually go through? So I'm summarizing them in 10 steps. So everything starts with an idea. So who has a great idea? All right, so, you see? You're not special. Sorry. There are billions of other people who actually have great ideas, right? The key is how to take your idea from an idea to an actual business. And there are 10 steps for that. The first step is just do a sanity check on it. So you got this idea, you're taking a shower and you got this like idea that's gonna change the world. What do you do next? What's the first thing you're going to do? First thing is that you need to do an internal sanity check on it. The first thing that you need to look at is that are you solving a real problem? Because a lot of cool ideas, they're just vitamins. They're not painkillers, right? Who actually have their vitamin every day? Just raise your hand. All right, one, two. You say, people don't care much about vitamins, even though they're good for you. But if you have a pain, you're willing to, you're definitely not gonna miss that medicine, and you're definitely gonna pay a lot of money for it. So whatever idea you have, make sure that it is, you're solving a real pain, and it's not a vitamin. The second piece is, the last thing you want to do is to solve a problem of which there's no big market for it, right? So even though if it is a pain, you wanna make sure that the target addressable market for that idea is really big. So you wanna make sure that you, there is a really big market for it. Because at the end of the day, you want this idea to make you money, right? And the third piece is, and you have to be honest with yourself, do you have what it takes to actually execute on this idea and build it, right? You can have an idea, it's like, oh, I wanna modify the human genome, and you don't know anything about biology, right? And you don't know anything about, you know, human genome. You're not, probably you're not really, you know, well-suited to actually run this company or actually take it to this level. So see if you're uniquely positioned or you have skill sets that are so unique that can actually help you to launch this idea. The second step is validate this idea outside yourself, right? So build a pitch deck. That's the first thing you need to do. Build a pitch deck, build a presentation deck. But when you do it, don't build a presentation. Tell a story. Make sure you tell a story, you know, throughout, you know, how you actually tell your idea. So create a pitch deck, and the moment you do it, start testing on people that really like you, right? They want to be nice to you. Pitch it to your family. Pitch it to your friends, right? See if they actually like it. See if some of your friends would actually invest their own personal money in it, right? That's the first kind of first validation for your idea. Don't be afraid to share it with people because there's nothing special about your idea. It's all about how you're gonna execute on it. So share it with people, get their feedback, encourage them to criticize it and poke holes in it because that's what's gonna enable you to pitch it better and enhance it throughout time. Build a clickable prototype. It's really easy. If it's a software now, you don't have to build the program. Sketch things on a paper, use tools to create a clickable prototype and run it by people. But more importantly, and most importantly, run it by your potential customers. You wanna make sure, you know, show the clickable prototype to your potential customer. Ask them for your opinion. If you think it's an actual real problem, see if your customers or audience does think it's a real problem and it's solving something for them. So if you have a business-to-business product or a consumer product, run it by your target audience before you actually build it. Invest that money and risk your entire, you know, well-being and fortune on this company. Do that validation. It's really cheap. It's really easy. All you need to do is just run it and talk to people. And then third, startups are really hard. Making something from an idea to reality, it's really hard. But it's a little bit easier if you have great team with you, if you have great co-founders with you. So ask yourself, can you convince someone else other than you to leave their job or to take that risk and join your company, right? That's another validation. If you do this, you validate that people are willing to join your company and risk, you know, their career to execute this idea. If you do this, you know that your customers or potential customers do believe that your idea is valid, right? And then also you see that some people believe in it enough that may be willing to put some money. All of this validation you can do without building the product. Before you quit your job, before you risk anything. Make sure you do that sanity check and make sure you do that validation. Step three, so you validated the idea, it's great. So what do you do next? Company structure, right from the start. Create the company and the company's foundation on the right structure, especially if you have co-founders and people joining your team. You gotta decide what kind of company it's going to be. Is it a C Corp? Is it LLC? Is it Sharika Musahima Lubdaniya? Whatever that structure is, every company is different, right? And every company needs a different structure. You've gotta look at the right structure for your own company. The second thing you need to do, and a lot of co-founders miss this, you've gotta talk upfront on the operating agreement. Think of it, what are the laws that are gonna govern this company? How is this company is gonna be operated? It's really important to have an upfront and frank conversation with your team members and your co-founders to make sure you're all on the same page. And whatever you agree on, put it in writing. Don't like just have a lunch with somebody and agree on something and take their words for it. Anything you agree on, put it in writing, make sure it's documented and signed. So operating agreement is really important. Third thing, which is a really sensitive issue sometimes when you have multiple co-founders, the cap table. How are the shares that are gonna be distributed in the company, right? Who's gonna get 10%, 20%, 50%, right? That's something you really need to define right from the start. But more importantly, this is a, you know, an advice, never ever grant all the stocks to the co-founders, even if you found it, even to yourself, right from day one. What you need to do is to create what is called a vesting schedule. A vesting schedule is basically you tell somebody you're gonna get X percent or X number of shares if you stay in the company for the next 4 years. And then every year you vest that amount. Because the last thing you want to do is to create the company, even if you're the founder, and you own 60% or 70%, and you get investors and you get people in, and all of a sudden, 6 months later, you say like, oh, I just got a great job offer from Google, and you quit and you keep your shares. That's not fair. You need to earn your stock even though you founded the company. As a co-founder, everyone needs to own their stock and shares in the company, including the person who started and co-founded that company. So it's really important. The third next important thing in the structure is corporate governance. Make sure you as the CEO, you don't make all the decisions and you're like a dictator. You just say, I want this and it's gonna happen. The CEO or the co-founder has a boss and that boss is called the board of directors, right? It's easy, you can recruit independent board of directors. People who are experienced in this domain. You can recruit them, you tell them, you wanna join my board and I give you X amount of shares. Your co-founders, your teammates, people actually can give you an actual candid advice. Put them on your board, because the board is what hires and fires the CEO. The board approves budgets, and you want people that you have to report to. You don't want to be a CEO and hold the ultimate powers for everything. You want to report to people. You want to get into the habit of creating board decks and board presentations and present to the board and have them challenge you all the time. Because sometimes people working for you are not gonna challenge you. But people you're reporting to, it's their duty to challenge you and poke holes in what you're doing. Because this is really hard and a lot of mistakes could happen and you want every opinion that you can actually have. That's step three. Step four, all right, so you got the company, you got the team members, right? So what do you do next? Don't go and implement your entire vision. It might cost you hundreds of thousands of dollars. Define the minimum viable product, or what I would like to call the minimal lovable product. what is the minimal amount of features? Because most of users, 80% of users, are going to use 20% of the feature set that you're going to have. Find what is that core feature set in your product, that 20%, build it in a great way and make sure people love it. Because you want to test it out and you want to launch on the market and you want to iterate, because the best audience, the best feedback you get is from people who are going to use your product. And your product needs to be at its worst when you launch it, right? So minimal viable product is really important. Test it in a closed environment with people who are not going to tweet about it. Oh my God, this is bullshit, or I don't like it. Test it with closed environment, get feedback, and don't get offended, because a lot of founders and entrepreneurs, they're very passionate about this. It's their baby, yeah? No one likes someone calling their baby ugly, right? No one does, no one likes that. And the same thing with startup. You don't want someone, you know, you're not gonna like someone telling you like, this is the dumbest idea I've seen, or, oh, it's not working, I don't like it, right? You have to have empathy to your users, and you gotta listen to them and really listen carefully, because at the end of the day, if they like it and they love it, your product's gonna succeed. So put your ego aside. You're not the smartest person on the planet. You have an IQ almost equal to anyone else. It's all about how you approach a problem and you actually absorb ideas and listen, right? If you have a business-to-business, you know, an enterprise business, talk to these businesses. Try to get an LOI, a letter of intent. LOIs are not, you know, legally binding to these companies, but it shows intent. Because what you want to do, you want these data points, right? All over, from consumers, from investors, from teammates, from partners. You want these data points to show you that, yes, you're going on the right path. People would buy it. People would use it. That's step four. Step five, once you have an LOI, you have a clickable prototype, MVP, raise money. And only raise money when you need the money. Raise the seed round. Seed rounds are really interesting, because that's kind of usually the first round you're going to raise, right? And at this stage, most entrepreneurs are not experienced. So they don't know how liquidation preferences work. They don't know how preferred stock options work. What I recommend, so you don't spend time, because raising money takes so much time, a lot of time. So you don't wait, so you would prevent wasting a lot of time. If you can raise money from angel investors, which basically they call them angels, because these are people who are gonna invest in you before you actually before you're making money, right? An angel investor is basically usually high net worth individuals or people who had exits before. Try to approach angel investors and try to raise money from them. And try to raise money on a convertible note if you can, so you don't have a price round. So you don't have to take 3 months and tens of thousands of dollars of legal work. But if you can't, no problem, go to VCs, raise a price round, no problem with that. But if after all of this, no one is willing to give you the money, you gotta stop a little bit and ask yourself, am I pitching this right? Is this the right product? Because at one point, you need to criticize yourself. You know, you need to be self-critical. Because the pitch to investors, if this is a great idea, investors want to invest money. They don't want their money to be in the bank. No one likes to put their money in the bank, except my grandfather, probably. But no one likes to keep their money in the bank. They want to deploy their money. So it's in the best interest of people to actually invest in companies. If you cannot convince people that this is a great idea and to invest money, either you're too early, either you're pitching it wrong, either you don't have the right elements, or in a completely wrong place. So something is wrong. You've got to evaluate it. You've got to be honest with yourself. Step six. So you raised money. You have money in the bank. But I recommend pat yourself on the back for 5 minutes and then get to work. Because now things are going to get harder. So what you need to do, the first thing to do is you got to start need to hire people, right? And you're going to need to hire a core team. But before you do that, you got to sit and reflect a little bit. And you want to do, what you want to ask yourself is, what defines your company? What is the mission of your company, right? This is a really important, this is a really, really important piece, right? The mission and the long-term strategy for the company is much more important than how cool your coffee maker is. A lot of startups, they get money, and all of a sudden they get the bean bags and six ways to make coffee, and you get all these trips and perks and all of that. These are cool. But in order to hire talented people and highly qualified people, what you need to perfect and articulate in order to get people join your team is to define what is your company's mission. Why does your company exist beyond making money, right? Why are you creating this? Because talented people want to be part of things that are bigger than themselves. They don't want a job. They don't want a 9-to-5 job. They want something big. They want to believe they belong to something. They want to feel that they're changing the world and making an impact, that their life has a meaning. And focus on that and try to pitch it to your core team to have them join you. Create a culture when your team joins. The company culture is really important. You're the CEO, but you're just the focal point. What you need to create is a culture that is built first on radical candor, and which means basically whoever you are in the company, people should feel comfortable coming to you and be front and frank with you. People should feel comfortable to tell you the truth. If you're the CEO, anyone in the company should be able to knock on your door and come to you and tell you, well, this is stupid. I don't think what you're doing is right. You need to create a company that allows employees and give them the power to come to anybody and give them a radical candor and radical feedback. But of course, the feedback needs to be built on respect. And of course, everything in the company and the culture needs to be collaborative government, a culture. Not a culture where I'm gonna do it all. It's a team. It's really hard. Creating a company is really, really hard. And you want people to be collaborating with each other. Don't underestimate how talented and how capable your employees are or people working with you. Trust them. And if you don't trust them, ask yourself, why in the hell are they in the company? You should have trust in your coworkers and work with them, collaborate with them. Last piece on this one is, if you want to recruit highly skilled people and talented people already have jobs. They're not looking for a job because someone else already recruited them. The best way to recruit is to poach talented people from companies. That's what you need to do. If someone has been on the job market for 6 months or 12 months, you gotta ask yourself why. You need to get the best talent in your team. And the best talent is already doing work, already have a job. You've got to recruit them. Don't be stingy. Give them stock. Don't care about how much percentage you have in the company. Your company is worth zero at this point, and will stay worth zero until a liquidation event. Share your stock, share your company with people. Make sure you have a great mission to attract highly talented people in. That's step six. Step seven is product market fit. This is a really important stage. This is an important, really important step. Most of companies fail at this stage. This is the stage where you built a product, you're launching in the market, but you're trying to see if whatever you built scales, whatever you built has actually a business model that will make you profitable, and whatever you built is gonna create a really big company, right? And this is a really critical stage. Most of startups fail here because they had an MVP, they had a team, they raised a seed round, but then they go and you want to scale it in the market and they fail. They get a couple of customers, you get a false positive, and they fail. So you want to ask yourself this. These are the questions you need to answer. Is the market demanding your product or not? Do you have the right distribution model, right? But even if you have distributing product right, do you have the right revenue model? Are you pricing your product right? Right? Because at the end of the day, not all companies are like Facebook and Google, and you created, and you have millions of users, and now and you're not making money from them, and then you figure it out later. Most of businesses, real businesses, the beginning, you need to be making money. You need to show that you can make positive gross margins of your customers. So you've got to think of your revenue model, and you got to iterate and iterate and iterate until you figure out the answers for these questions. Figure out the right distribution model, the right revenue model, and make sure that the market is demanding your product. Step eight, and step seven, step eight, and nine, they could be intermingled. Is, okay, you figure out a business model, you're selling, right? You build a product, but how do you measure your business as a co-founder? How do you make sure that you're going on the right track? And what you need to do, and you need to follow it as a gospel, you need to create KPIs, which is basically key performance indicators in your business. What are the KPIs in your business that you need to define in order to track whether your business is going the right path or the wrong path? For example, if you're a services business, revenue is a KPI, EBITDA is a KPI, utilization of your employees is a KPI. If you're a consumer product, acquisition cost, number of users, lifetime value of customers. If you're a B2B product, your sales, your churn, your EBITDA. Every business has different types of KPIs. You need to define them and define the right KPIs, because if you define the wrong KPIs, you're gonna end up measuring the wrong thing. You wanna measure the right stuff for your business. The second thing is, and to me, this is the most important thing you need to be tracking in your startup, which is burn. Because a startup, at this stage, you're not profitable. You can't afford your employees. The only reason you're in market, because some investor invested money in you. And that money becomes less and less and less every month. So the burn is really important. Burn measure is really important. You need to do it. And you gotta measure your employees. Are they happy? Are they inspired? Are they motivated? A lot of startups fail because they can't retain employees. Nine, you raise the Series A or B. And you don't raise it, if you want to raise the Series B, you want to make sure that you have the right product market fit, you already have sales, you already have KPIs, and you're going to use the money just for scale. And if you've managed to grow the business, and you scale the business, at some point, you're gonna start asking yourself, what is the liquidation event, right? Because that's every startup needs to get to, I'm gonna drink water, sorry. Every startup needs to get to a liquidation event, whether it's an IPO or another company buying you or just stay private. Sorry. And if you get to a liquidation event, then you can go to Hawaii and retire. All right? Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. I don't know how you did this, because it sounded sometimes like you were suffering a lot. But thank you so much for taking the time. You can go there and they'll... They'll unmic you on the side. Thank you so much. So, big round of applause for Mark, please, especially for his trying really hard to speak to you guys. Right now, we're going to have the Innovation Weekend. I'll let Tamara introduce the concept, but we'll take 1 minute break just to get the competition and everything set up for the people. So just stay here. It will start in 1 minute. Okay? Thank you.